pioneer in this industry, Salcedo Auctions is set to celebrate their 10th year anniversary this July, albeit on a much more somber note given this pandemic. Here's my chat with their founder and chairman, Richie Lerma, about their shift to an online bidding platform and how it can be just as or even more exciting than the traditional live in-person auction. Hi, Richie. Thanks for being here with us.
Thanks for having me, Mike, in your program.
So, Richie, this July, Salcedo Auctions was supposed to celebrate its 10th year as a fine arts auction house. How has the pandemic affected your business?
Like everybody else, of course, we've had our challenges. But the great thing about our being prepared for what the pandemic has brought us, which is our shifting into the online field, was quite seamless. As part of our 10th anniversary, we were looking to launch our own online bidding platform. So the timing couldn't have been better. I wish it was under better circumstances, of course, in light of everything that's going on. But as a business, it was great that we were prepared. We had been doing online auctions for the past 2 years through a third-party platform. But for the sake of the security of our clients' information, of course, and to protect their privacy, etc., we thought that it was very important for us to have our own online platform, which we had been developing. And so with the pandemic, we easily shifted to that. Any challenges that came with that was simply being able to get used to the fact that we would be operating online for the time being. And of course, the logistical challenges that come with that. But by and large, it was a seamless shift. So we're very grateful for that.
Okay, interesting that you are primed for this and that you had already, through your third-party provider, you had already been doing these online auctions. Now, an auction in itself is it's a sensory experience. It's the competition, the adrenaline of the hammer going down in person. So what are the elements and how much better is the online experience as opposed to the traditional in-person experience?
Of course, the traditional in-person experience is without a doubt the best way to not just experience the art or the other valuable objects that we're presenting, but also, as you mentioned, the theatricality of the auction, where you have the auctioneer in front of you, you know, wielding his gavel and selling to the room. Nothing beats that, of course. The challenge is, of course, to be able to approximate that particular feeling or sense of place within the online realm. And so that's what we've tried to do through the various online platforms that we've brought to the fore in line with this pandemic. We have a subsidiary called Salcedo Private View, for example, that does gallery exhibitions and private sales. And so one way that we were able to adapt was to present an online gallery, a virtual gallery, that enables you to actually work your way through the space and see the objects and scale and be able to come up close and make inquiries directly, at least via your computer or your mobile. Now, in terms of the online auctions, we've been able to still continue, I think, that sense of drama by slowly rolling out the auctions, of course, communicating with our audiences, sending them teasers, and then unfurling our catalogs, and then inviting them to register, keeping them excited, so to speak. Once you enter the online auction room, there is still, of course, that sense of place you're within, looking at the screen or your phone, the objects come up, and it's not as if there is an unlimited time, for example, for you to come and bid. There is this adrenaline rush that you experience.
The timer helps.
That's right.
Yeah, the timer helps.
And it moves very quickly. It all really depends on the platform as well as the competition. Any other person that is on their phone or on the computer ready to press click or bid, for example, you don't know when they're actually going to come in and you're just thinking about coming to bid and they've already clicked ahead of you and the bid is with them and you're not given much time. So there is that theatricality and drama. People who've experienced our online auctions have enjoyed it tremendously. It's very entertaining. I mean, for those that are, you know, serious enough to participate and sit through it, it is really quite entertaining, quite engaging, if I might say so.
And more importantly, you can do it from the comfort and safety of your own home.
That's correct. So, the only thing that you're missing, of course, is being able to see the objects up close. However, the online platform allows you to come as close as possible to the piece. It allows you to zoom in. And for example, for the sculptures, for example, you're able to even see the objects in three dimensions. So these are things that perhaps even when you go to our sale room or to our gallery to take a look at the pieces, you might perhaps not take the time to actually see the object in the round or see things up close or to zoom in, etc. So online, you're able to do that. Of course, one other thing that I might say is that with the easing of restrictions, you are still able to come to our premises to view the actual pieces. We just, of course, need to exercise the social distancing and ensuring that only a very limited number of people come. But you can set an appointment our space is large enough
that to actually you can view actually, this. And you can do the social distancing even with a few people there. Yes, there. That's right. Yeah. This is not a crowded room type of view.
No, it's not.
Yes, definitely. And you can definitely even do it by appointment to make sure there's absolutely no one but you there. So I'm great. I'm happy you have the latitude and the scope to do this and your online platform. You are ready for this and it's quite robust. Now, here's the thing. Do you think the economic toil brought about by COVID-19 will significantly cut the demand for the luxury market segment?
I think that we'd be kidding ourselves if we thought that the pandemic wouldn't have an effect on the art market. But I think what's very important, and especially in light of everything that's going on as well, and people might even be questioning the whole concept of luxury or indulgence in light of everything that's going on. And I'm not just talking about the pandemic. I'm talking about the social upheavals that are going on at this time. I think what's very, very important for us to keep in mind is to really, I think we need to define what luxury is. Because if you go down to the root of it, it's being able to simply have a life that is comfortable and a life that is, for whatever measure, being human, we all seek pleasure. Now, in terms of what level of luxury we are looking at, that all really depends on the individual, whatever their circumstances are, whatever their environment is. Everybody has their own definition of what is luxurious. I think it's not uncalled for me to say that I think everybody aspires to have a modicum of luxury in their lives. We all, as humans, like to have comfort or pleasure. When it comes to art, for example, it allows us, for example, to get the pleasure that comes from being surrounded, for example, by things of beauty. The pleasure of looking at objects that make us think, that make us appreciate the amount of work or artisanship that people put in to these objects that we offer. Objects that give us a sense of history, for example.
Luxury, yeah, it's a deeply personal concept. And I was reading about this online in preparation for this interview, there was this article I came across, and one auction house said, you know, you can't control what's going on and a lot of bad things are happening, but you can hang a Picasso or a Van Gogh on your wall or whatever to you is that Picasso or Van Gogh on the wall, and then it makes everything better.
That's true. You know, right now, you know, with the pandemic, a lot of people are cocooning. I mean, those that are fortunate enough to be cocooning, for example, then we're looking at the space that, we're surrounded by, and we're looking for joy within the spaces that we are confining ourselves in. And if that joy comes from looking at, let's say, a work by a Filipino master or by a Filipino contemporary visual artist, that search for joy is certainly valid, and that's something that will always be sought out for. And Salcedo Auctions is, of course, there to be able to address that particular need, which is not going to go away in spite of all of the difficulties that people have. People are experiencing this pandemic in various measures, of course. I think being mindful of the hardship that's going on outside allows one to be very thankful as well for one's blessings, and to be able to find joy in as well in the luxuries that one is able to surround ourselves with. But if I might add, Mikey, as well, there is also a certain, I think, joy that comes when we have this sense of appreciation by surrounding by ourselves with things that speak to our higher selves. It also allows us to open our hearts and to open our minds to everything that's going on outside. It allows us to be responsive as well, because once we start appreciating these things, we appreciate as well the goodness of man, you know, the beauty of of nature, for example, the world that's being rocked right now. When we are cocooned and looking at these objects, we see hope. And it is in this hope, for example, that we see that we're able to go beyond ourselves, to start to think about not just ourselves, but about others. We have to see beauty, because otherwise there is no hope. There is nothing for us to aspire for. There is Absolutely.
That's right. Richie, what's your outlook for the market that is able to afford these fine arts, these collectibles? What's your outlook for that, given the dire economic circumstances, the lengthy lockdown, and the difficult months to come? What do you think has happened to this segment that can afford these things?
I feel very fortunate for Salcedo Auctions that we continue to thrive in spite of the pandemic. But I think what's very important to note, that even knowing all of that as well, is that we need to be responsive. We're not tone deaf in terms of what's going on outside as well. So I think in terms of the outlook for this segment, what I would recommend, and I think I'd like to say that, you know, Salcedo Auctions being the pioneer and being one of the few Filipino luxury brands, if I might call it that, is that, you know, we need to be able to carry on with our business, our luxury businesses, with a sense of responsibility and with a set, with a purview to what is going on as well. You know, this is not the time to flaunt. This is not the time to be crassly speaking about multi-million peso, you know, sort of like paintings, even if that is the truth for some of these sort of things. What is important is being able to underscore the meaning, the value, the raison d'etre for such value being there. And I think that's what's important for our, for the luxury market to continue to be relevant. You know, luxury also must come with a sense of purpose. And that's something that I think I can say for Salcedo Auctions that has been in our DNA since we started. And if I'd like to say as well that I think the luxury segment, those that survive this pandemic, are those that have always had this in its, at its core, you know, this integrity, for example, that it's not all crass commercialism, because art should not be that. Of course, this is a business, and we're not going to deny that. But what is important is that we do not put front and center crass commercialism. There is a reason for luxury. It's about bringing to the fore higher values, a sense of aesthetics, for example, discernment, exacting tastes, etc. A search for excellence, the importance of excellence. We need to bring that forward all the time. And for people in the luxury market, we need to uphold that to continue to be relevant. And if I may suggest, to continue to thrive, even in challenging times.
That's right. And these are challenging times. So you've been holding online auctions for 2 years now. You've had a couple already, even during this, even during the lockdown. How has demand for the pieces been online prior to COVID and throughout this challenging period?
Well, certainly, you know, the big sales happen live. Although, you know, there are people that are more and more comfortable bidding online, so they give people a run for their money, so to speak, when they bid as well. There is competition that comes from online. So when we were doing this pre-pandemic, you'd have people challenging the live bidders online. Other than that, of course, on the phone, or people would have left absentee bids, for example. But of course, now that we are in the situation where we're doing our auctions all online as well, we've had tremendous results. For example, when we did the auction on the 18th of April, to raise, well, this one was in working with the great Cebuano artist Romulo Golicano, who created this painting that was his response to the pandemic, and it was being sold to raise funds for PPEs for you know, frontliners in Cebuano hospitals, that reached over 4 million pesos, and the bidding was done online. I think we hold, Salcedo definitely, at least in the Philippines, holds the record when it comes to even bidding online, that people are comfortable to be bidding at those levels in Salcedo. And it comes with the trust, I suppose, with the platform. And this was already utilizing our own platform. After that, last May, we did a fundraising auction for Rise Against Hunger, Gabalin Block. You know, we raised I think over 3 million pesos clean to the organization. And that's from the proceeds from the sale. And that's just not even counting, you know, all of these paintings that are selling in the 6 and 7 figures. All of these bids were coming through online.
So, that's right. Well, you've been in the business for 10 years now, and you've established quite a reputation, and the trust is there. And through your platform, you're able to bring together art enthusiasts, art patrons, and causes to support, which is which are beneficial to those that need it. So good for you guys. Apart from the online component, how else have you guys pivoted in response to this pandemic, business-wise?
Okay. I think what's very important, actually, I've been thinking a lot about one of the most famous the operative word during this crisis has been pivoting. I think one needs to reflect on the idea of pivoting. Remember that one needs to be able to pivot from something rather than creating something that's new. You need to be attached to something to be able to shift, rather than you know, simply creating something from out of nowhere. What is very important for those that have been successful in pivoting is that, you know, when they do make that pivot, it is still grounded or attached to the core of the business. And I think that's something that a lot of people should keep in mind. And this isn't just about the luxury segment, obviously, but other segments as well. So, for example, in addition to the online auctions that we've been doing, we've also had the gallery sales in the spaces that we've created. One thing that we've also pioneered and as part of our pivoting was also to introduce the idea of virtual vernissages. And I think that the media was very pleased to see how we continued to hold cocktail receptions even while we were all separated. So we were together, you know, during our Zoom community calls. And what we did was we would have our vernissages and we would have our caterers deliver to each and every confirmed guest. So we were toasting to Aperols and, you know, having our canapes from the privacy of our homes. Yes. So, I mean, these are things that you still are able to, you know, live through the difficulty, but still have a sense of a place and community, even online. So that's another way I think that we've pivoted in terms of how we could still remain as a community, even if, of course, the challenges of being physically separated are there. We've also had, educational platforms that we've began, especially now that people are at home, kids are all, cooped up. At home for, it's been months, for example, and who knows when school will start once again in physical space. So a workshop on printmaking, for example, in line with our editions auction in June, is a good place to be able to continue that conversation while continuing to educate the market and see the merit in the pieces that are on offer.
Okay, well, it's good that you guys are forging on, because in this, in this subset of the luxury market industry, there are jobs to be created, there are jobs to be kept, and the fact that you guys are continuing to do what you do and finding new ways to do what you do means a lot of people will remain to be employed. So that's fantastic. Now, on a more personal note, Richie, what's it like to be a leader during a pandemic, an entrepreneur, a leader during this?
I felt that, when the pandemic was upon us and people were looking to Salcedo, particularly, not just in the arts segment, but also in the luxury segment as well, in terms of how we could move forward. It comes with a sense of responsibility as well. And that's why we've been very, very mindful to not be tone deaf in light of everything that's going on. One of the obvious fallouts from all of these is, of course, with the crisis that's taking place, is it still relevant? There's always the question of, is luxury still relevant? Do all of these things still make sense? We firmly believe that it does, and we continue to conduct our business and conduct ourselves accordingly. And I think that that is what is important when it comes to being a pioneer or being a leader, that there is that sense of responsibility. There is that sense of also being able to stay strong. It's very important to show people that one is, that one carries on in spite of all of these challenges, because, luxury, like I said, has always been a bellwether for the economy, where things are going. And if we buckle under this, where will everybody else go as well? Of course, there are the necessities, but what sort of life would it be if we were just simply hand to mouth, for example, without, of course, belittling at all that? Very important, of course, everybody needs to live. But beyond that, what is life worth living if there's nothing more to that? So we need to be able to still present ourselves as relevant, and I believe that we are, by the work that we do, by the charities that we continue to support, that we've been fortunate enough that the business has grown to this extent that we've been able to support these charities as well. So there is that sense of responsibility, and I'd like to invite other business owners as well, that philanthropy is something that needs to be in the DNA of people. It needs to be genuine. It needs to be, it needs to be responsive.
Mm-hmm. And similarly, Richie, what's your outlook for art exhibits. You know, we've come to look forward to art in the park.
Yes.
We've come to look forward to the exhibits at the Link parking lot.
Yes.
What now?
Well, I think everybody is in a wait and see attitude in terms of seeing, in terms of determining if we are ever going to come out of this this lockdown, because it seems to be an ongoing series of, you know, a new and improved community quarantine every 15 days or so. I think that with that in mind, being in the creative industries, we need to continue to think outside the box, to be able to not just sit back and, you know, just mutter to ourselves complaining about what's going on. We have no control over what is happening, but what we do have control over is our response. And that is, we must continue to engage. We must continue to find ways to bring people together, to have the economy still moving. Now, as far as the art market is concerned, as mentioned, you know, you do have those online platforms. It's by no means perfect, but it's a start. And I think one thing that this pandemic has achieved is that more and more people who used to not be comfortable with technology are becoming adept at using it and are growing in their knowledge. So that, you know, in fact, the pandemic has brought, in spite of everything, it has opened up all of these opportunities and learnings for people. Of course, we all look forward to the day when we can all be together physically, and we work, you know, with that in mind, working towards that. So I don't think we're all just simply waiting, of course, for that vaccine or for that solution, for example, when we can all comfortably go out there. Is it in the horizon? I think so. I remain very hopeful, because I'm also,
fingers crossed.
Yes, fingers crossed that there will be that solution and we'll all still be out there. But that being said, we must carry on. We must mm-hmm. carry on.
Mm-hmm. You know, that being said, Richie, in your space, how have you seen consumer behavior change? And what do you think of these changes are short term? And what of these changes are here to stay?
I think, let me respond to the latter question first. What's here to stay is, I think, the online platform. Because I think one good thing I have heard from some people, that some people quite enjoy just simply being at home. They're coming to realize as well that, you know, being at home and being able to do so many things is not so bad as well. People, there is a comfort in, you know, being ensconced in one's own space and being able to achieve so many things. Now, with technology and all of that, we're not going to turn back the clock. I think that's here to stay. And we will just simply continue to develop our level of comfort in terms of technology. So that's here to stay. Now, in terms of how things are, obviously right now, some people are still nervous, of course, and rightfully so, to be with other people at such close distance. There doesn't seem to be, as far as we can see for now, an ebbing in terms of the exponential growth or spread. But that being said, there is still the possibility, at least within our space, set an appointment, or even if there's a group of people, because the space is large enough, you can actually spread out within the space to still be able to enjoy the art. So it's being able to adapt to the situation. We will always find a way to carry on.
Adapt, find ways, and as you said, carry on. Thank you for that, Richie Lerma of Salcedo Auctions.
Thank you, Mikey.